Problem 5. For each integer n greater than or equal to 1, let f of n be the number of lists of different positive integers starting with 1 and ending with n, in which each term except the last divides its successor. Prove that for each integer big N greater than or equal to 1, there is an integer n greater than or equal to 1, such that big N divides f of n. So f of 1 is 1, f of 2 is 1, and f of 6 is 3. If we're going to start thinking about this problem, it makes sense to start by using a number that's got factors that are easy to understand. So I'm going to start by thinking about powers of 2, like 2 to the k, because their factors are things we can just write in a list. The factors of 2 to the k are the powers of 2 up to 2 to the k itself. So I've got 2 to the 0, which is 1, 2 to the 1, which is 2, and so on up to 2 to the k itself. Now, what we're asked to count is the number of lists of factors where every term divides the one after it. So the rules say I've got to start with 1, and the rules say I've got to finish with 2 to the k itself, but I can choose or not choose to have any of the terms in between. So I could choose to have 2, I could choose not to have 4, I could choose some of the ones in the middle, and then maybe I could choose to have 2 to the k minus 1. Now, this is easy to count because I've got k minus 1 independent choices. Choose this or not, choose this or not, and so on up to this. So that means that there are 2 to the k minus 1 different lists, because that's choices of two things, yes or no, k minus 1 times. So f of 2 to the k is 2 to the k minus 1, which is a nice number. Unfortunately, this alone is not going to solve the problem. So we were asked to find a number that was a multiple of n for any n, and unfortunately, if we find that f of 2 to the k is 2 to the k minus 1, this means the numbers that this is going to have as a factor are quite limited. So we're going to have to try something else in order to get bigger examples with more factors. If we're trying to think of numbers where there'll be more factors and more going on, it's pretty natural to have the idea of trying numbers with lots of different prime factors, like say 30 is 2 times 3 times 5. Unfortunately, if we draw the graph explaining which factors there are and how they divide each other, it looks kind of complicated. And if we added another prime factor again, like 7, to get 210, this diagram would get even more complicated. And I thought about this for a while, but I couldn't think of any good way to count these, so I gave up. It turns out to be a rather better idea to think about the number 2 to the k times 3. So 2 to the k times 3 has some factors that are a bit more complicated than those of 2 to the k, but only a bit more. And I've drawn out a diagram that shows all the factors. There are the powers of 2 from 2 to the 0 up to 2 to the k, and there are the powers of 2 times 3 from 2 to the 0 times 3 to 2 to the k times 3. Of course, the rules say we've got to have 1 in our list, and we've got to have 2 to the k times 3 in our list. But it's a little more complicated to say what we can have between. We're not just choosing some of them and leaving some of them out, because we've got to make them a list where each term divides the term after it. This looks hard to count, and in situations like this, it's a good idea to try to break it up into smaller chunks, which are easier to count. One way we can break it up in this case is to ask ourselves what the last term we use in the top row is. So we can break it up based on whether the last term in the top row is 1 or 2 or 4 or so on up to 2 to the k. Let's talk about this in turn. If the last term in the top row is 1, then that means we can use or not use any of the bottom row. So we can use or not use 3, use or not use 6, use or not use 12, and so on. And that gives us a term of 2 to the k, because there are k different choices of things to use or not use. If the last term in the top row that we use is 2, we have fewer choices though. So if we use 2, then we use or not use 6, use or not use 12, and so on, but we don't have the choice of 3 anymore. So that gives us 2 to the k minus 1 possibilities. If the last term in the top row we use is 4 again, then we now have a choice of 2, and we now have a choice of the bottom row starting from 12. So again, we've got k minus 1 different terms that we can choose or not choose, And that gives us another 2k minus 1. Then, lastly, I mean, if we continue in this way, if the last term in the top row that we use is 2 to the k, then there are these k minus 1 terms in the top row that we use, and we can't use any of the bottom row except the one we're forced to use, 2 to the k times 3. So this gives us a whole bunch of terms of 2 to the k minus 1. In fact, there are k of these terms. 1 corresponding to each possible last place in the top row from 2 to the 1 up to 2 to the k. So we've got k terms of 2 to the k minus 1, and then 2 more 2 to the k minus 1s disguised as a 2 to the k. So I can write that as saying that f of 2k times 3 is equal to k plus 2 times 2 to the k minus 1. Now this is very good news for us. We wanted something that has n as a factor. And this bracket of k plus 2 here means we can choose k in order to get any factor we want pretty well. So if we want that factor of n, we can take f of 2 to the n minus 2 times 3, and that will be n times 2 to the n minus 3. And this will work provided n is big enough. But if we check it quickly, we realize that the only cases where this doesn't work are cases we've already done in the earlier example of 2 to the k itself. So this example does everything we need.